Here.
Grandy? Gregory?
Here.
Harrington? Here. Horner?
Here.
Muro?
Here.
Kling? Sarbaugh? Sarbaugh? Sarbaugh?
Here.
Soraya? Swickard?
Here.
Tripp?
Here.
Wether?
Here.
Zeth?
Here.
And Sarka?
Here.
Okay, did everybody get a chance to review the minutes from the March 19th? Do you have a motion to approve?
Make a motion to approve the minutes.
Second.
All favor?
Aye.
Vote. Okay, now we will have a public speaks forum, if there's anybody wishing to speak to our council.
Chuck Osborne, 307 Fairview Street, Southeast North Canton, Ohio. I left this one piece of information on your desk. Took me 8 hours to put this together. What it attempts to document is back from the time I was on council for decades, or many years, council met religiously every single Monday, 4 Mondays a month, as their council rules mandated. In the last couple of years, they are combining multiple meetings per month down to 1 or 2 meetings. Now, they champion and state over meeting and more meetings. Well, having 3-4 meetings in one night is not productive, and again, it's in violation of the city's ordinances. They've reduced the number of meeting nights. We're talking about meeting nights, not meetings. 25% since what they have done for many, many years. So do we need some kind of penalties for not complying with the charter? Do we need to maybe bring in an outside attorney who will document this? Because council and the mayor, they just dismiss whatever the citizenry bring to their attention. Secondly, last week, Moderator Fox told you that any meeting not held on a Monday night, if it's held on a Tuesday, any other day of the week, it instantly becomes a special council meeting or a special committee meeting. Is that even logical? I ask you just to think for yourself. It's ludicrous. Again, all through this 14-year period, if there was a holiday on a Monday and the council prearranged to have it on a Tuesday, it was a council meeting. It was a committee meeting. A special council meeting should be called, and there's 3 different ways you can call one. Read through the charter there. It's for a special reason. And when you ask for a special council meeting, you have to detail what that meeting is about. And that's the only thing that can be discussed. So to say that any meeting not held on a Monday night instantly becomes a special council meeting is ludicrous. I haven't gone back and looked, counted the number of special council meetings last year. We're up to like 30, 35, I don't even know. Special council meetings. And that is not correct. And you were given misinformation. So I'm going to tell you that from 16 years of experience. Mr. Wechter could probably confirm it. Larry Tripp, who comes to the meetings regularly. Jessica has been coming about 6 or 8 months. You have to have come up to these meetings to see the how things progress. Thank you.
Tim Fox is on the city's law director, and I just want to point out that although Mr. Osborne has in his own mind what indeed is called a special meeting, that's actually defined by Ohio Revised Code. It's in the Open Meetings Act, and it has very specific requirements for what constitutes a special meeting, what constitutes an emergency meeting, regardless of what Mr. Osborne believes, again, in his own mind, here in a few minutes, what I'll do is go ahead and go in the back and I'll bring these things out and show you that it's not, it's one of those things that I had mentioned that you may not amend in a charter certain general types of rules. And one of those, two of those are actually those that relate to public records as well as open meetings. By charter, you wouldn't be able to say that all of council meetings are private. You would be in violation of the Open Meetings Act, and as a general law, you wouldn't be able to amend that as a home rule ordinance. So, again, just so you're aware, that's not something that we make up. It's one of those general rules, and it's really important, I believe, certainly, so that other municipalities don't attempt to take advantage of having a lack of transparency for their meetings and so forth. So I'll go ahead and take care of that for you.
Anyone else
would
you speak? City name and address for the record.
Lynn Moeller. I live on Harmon, Southwest here in North Canton. And I have a concern about a vacant house. It has been vacant for over 20 years.
I think you're at the wrong meeting. This is Charter Review Commission, and I think maybe you want to come to a council meeting.
Yeah, that's what I thought this was. Oh, I'm so sorry.
That's okay. And we have two council people here that, you know, after the meeting, maybe they need to speak to you about it.
Okay.
Or put it in writing and...
Okay, because I need some guidance.
Yep.
So these
are good answers.
Okay, thank you.
That's okay. Okay, before we get started, there was something that I wanted to bring up. You know, we're 2 months late getting started, so we're going to have to really go through this and then do it again. That's the first thing I'm going to mention. The second thing is there's always a lawyer appointed to the commission for a reason. We have a lawyer appointed to answer the commission's legal questions, like what is Ohio Revised Code, what is our charter, what are our ordinances, or any other legal thing that comes up. So from here on in, I would like to propose that any questions you have, you address our lawyer. Then if she needs further clarification, then she can ask the law director. And then the law director can answer it with a 5-minute minimum. And if it's going to take more than 5 minutes, then they can perhaps talk after the meeting or another time convenient to them. Okay, so.
I have a request, ma'am. I don't know if we need to vote on this or not, but I appreciate the time and effort that I didn't know where this came from, Mr. Osborne. I appreciate the time and effort that she took to put this together. However, I personally would like to limit what's put in my area, those things initiated by the Charter Review Committee. I don't want to get confused with additional documents. Now, I would like that for me. I would suggest that happen with the rest of the council. And if Mr. Osborne or someone else would like to present some data, they could put it out there where any of the committee members can pick that up.
Okay, let's take a vote on both issues.
I move that. I so move.
Oh, are you moving on what I propose?
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, Mitch, I'm sorry. I thought we had one thing. Go ahead.
Mayor, I will make a motion that we approve what you propose.
Okay.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Now we can take a vote.
I'm sorry, I missed your move.
That's okay. So something's been brought forward that if somebody wants to bring information to the commission, that they put it on the table and then explain during their 3 minutes what it is, and then anybody that wants to pick it up can pick it up. Is that okay?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Madam Chairman, I had the question after looking at we read something and, you know, we kind of agree upon it, are we going to have an opportunity to go back and discuss it further?
If the commission wants to do that.
The reason, I mean.
I'm not the boss.
Okay.
Everybody has to agree.
Because meetings are the prime example. We've already went over it last week. Here was a great example tonight of a lady coming into a meeting, not knowing it was. Had she known council meets every Monday night, the first and second week, she might have known. I can't say she might have missed it otherwise, but that's why, again, I feel strongly we have to revisit meetings to suggest that. Remember, we're not making any rules. We're making a suggestion to council to change the charter. We can't do it ourselves. But we can make it 16, you know, weeks a year, whatever we want. I'm being facetious there, but I'm just saying, we can make whatever recommendation, and they don't have to do anything with it. You know, that am I correct, Mary?
Correct.
So, again, I think we should go back, or have the opportunity to go back and discuss things maybe deeper, that we've missed some things. Because, to be frank, again, I don't want to take up the meeting, but meetings at least once during each calendar month. Okay. That doesn't say much. Is it going to be a regular council meeting or a council meeting of the whole? So, with that, I will close, but I do feel
Mr.
we should.
Mr. Fox, while you were going.
Sir, I'm talking.
Excuse me.
No, thank you. Thank you.
While you were going, we decided if anybody had anything extra to give, they would explain it and they would take it and the people would pick it up.
Okay, well, okay. I think it's important. He just told you that this was not in accordance with Ohio law.
Okay, I'm not sorry, but I'm going to make a proposal that we have the opportunity to go back and reopen a certain portion of our previous readings.
Is that the kind of thing we should take a vote on? We do need to move, like you said, we do need to move forward.
That's correct. Right. Time is of the essence.
I feel like if enough people feel like we need to go back and do it, rather than leave this. Yes,
we
need to go back and ask
you. Go through everything and write down what you want to go back and then begin.
Okay.
Satisfactory to everybody? Yeah. Okay. And Mr. Wetter.
Okay. Did everybody have a chance to read the communication that I got from the law director? In regard to the number of times that the council met. I'd like to point out that in actuality, the council met 33 times, not 54. Difference is that the law director was counting multiple meetings in conjunction with the council meeting and counting them as separate meetings. But there were only six meetings in 2016 in which there was not either an executive session or a special committee meeting or council of the whole meeting in conjunction with the regular council meeting 33 times.
So only, there were only six meetings in which there were no additional meetings from one of those sources that I pointed out. Council did not meet, let's see, they met on July 11th and then again on August 22nd. That summer adjournment has always been taken by every council. And I'm not sure if they met on December 19th and then not again until January 23rd. And I think that's one of Larry's problems, and maybe what has led to his feeling so strongly about this. But I think in all fairness, it would be misleading if I didn't point out that members spend a lot of time outside of this room with their constituents. A lot of time. They're contacted by constituents who either want to express concerns about maybe something the city is doing. One of the issues that I oftentimes heard about was snow plows are covering my driveway. I just showed that. But I mean, I had to explain to him, you know, what's the alternative? In one case, I'm not bragging here, but in one case, there was an elderly man who shouldn't have been shoveling his driveway to begin with. But he called me and he said, hey, they just covered my driveway again. I grabbed his shovel and went down there and shoveled out his driveway. It was easier than, but I know that other councilmen do the same kinds of things in response to constituent problems. They're contacted all the time about constituents registering complaints, and guess what the biggest complaint is? Speeding. And the police department is very responsive to that. They will have a cruiser set in an area where the constituents are complaining about, but of course they can't do that, you know, in every area where people complain about relationships with neighbors. He's planting trees on my property lines. My neighbor lets his cat run wild. And did you know that we have a cat ordinance?
Yeah, yeah. Does that speak to the number of times the council meets?
What's that?
Are you still speaking to the amount of times that the council meets? Or are you talking about how much extra time the council members put in? And I agree that they do. I think the question, excuse me for interrupting, Mrs. Kessler, but I think the question we need to look at here is not how many times council meets, but is the city's business being done efficiently and effectively? That's the question. Not how frequently it meets, but whether the city's business is getting done. That's the question we have to answer. The standard here is the minimum time that they have to meet. Our ordinances say they have to meet more than that. I think this is working.
Well, I just want to point out that in addition to spending money in this chamber.
That's what makes the council work. All the stuff that's going on outside.
change if it needs change. And I feel like a lot of the time, I'm just hearing, they're not doing this, or they are doing this. What do we want to change? Because that's what we're writing down. So, I mean, I'm totally for supporting everyone's opinion. I think it's, you have to. That's the only way we're going to get stuff done, because you need that material behind it. I'm just a little worried that we're using too much supporting material and not enough change.
Justin, you're making a good point. And then, you know, I mean, the same thing that we sort of said throughout, I just want to reiterate that the ordinance, you know, like you said, says the minimum, or excuse me, the charter says the minimum, you know, of what council needs to do. The ordinance says what they do have to follow. And what we're here to do is to review the charter. And, you know, if council isn't following the ordinance, this isn't the place. I mean, we can't change that. This isn't the place to change that. So, you know, these are good discussions, and maybe they're good to have outside of this when you're, you know, kind of election time or whatnot. But as far as, you know, what we're here to do, like just as I said, is to make sure the ordinance is setting the right standard, making sure the charter is setting the right standard for the ordinance. Excuse me.
Okay. Why don't we start with section 2.05, legislative procedure. Anybody have any problems with that? I think that's pretty standard. Quorum is a certain percent of the whole. The second paragraph. I was asked by someone to bring up about voting and calling a roll call, which is very time consuming. Perhaps it could just be, how to word this, like we're doing it, just, you know, all in favor of or all opposed. But the downside to that is when you read the minutes, then you would not know who voted for what and who didn't vote for what.
Well, do you record that in the minutes? I mean, if somebody votes against something, you write that down, right? I mean,
it's recorded in the minutes, and there's seven people, and if six vote yes, one votes no. I recorded as roll call vote, six yes, one no, and whoever voted no. So it is recorded within our minutes.
With a roll call, but if you would change it to just, you know, all in favor or not in favor, then you could lose that portion of it.
We call it a voice vote, and clerk. No. I'm your attorney. I'm this group's.
Please.
I am your attorney. I represent you guys. I'm your.
We voted and decided that we would, anything legal wise, would be addressed to the attorney on the commission.
That's, you don't have the authority to do that. This is a legislative meeting, and you're appointed by council.
Okay.
And as its legal representative, I am as well your legal representative. And I simply wanted to say the word that's sort of the term is simply a voice vote. And you may put it in the charter that a clerk with a voice vote note who voted in favor and who voted not in favor.
Okay. So after reading this, do you feel that you want to leave it like it is, or do you want to change it? Affirmative
vote and
negative vote.
I was asked to bring it up, that's why I'm bringing it up.
Sure.
It seems fine for me the way it is.
Third paragraph.
you have a problem, you can stop and we'll discuss it, okay? Or stop me and then we'll discuss it. Are you ready to go to the next paragraph, starting with an affirmative vote?
I guess I have a question, just when it says shall be fully distinctly read at free and regular council meetings unless council votes as suspensible, are there any legal requirements? Like, what is it, what is, how does that work?
Right.
Is it suspensible, is there, I mean, can they do that whenever? Or is there actual,
sorry, I like that. No. That's a good question, and that is actually something that, and this is why we have Mr. Fox here, because, this is how we
can. We're on page 8,
before we start, I'd ask you, please limit your answer to about 5 minutes.
I'll do my very best, yes.
Sorry, I'm on page 8, in that second paragraph, an affirmative vote.
Okay.
It's halfway through, it says shall be fully and distinctly read at three different regular council meetings unless the council votes to suspend this rule. Is there any standard?
Is that part of the revised code, or is that?
It indeed is. It's three readings unless that's waived. Yes.
So it's, I'm sorry.
It's three readings unless that rule is waived. You have to state the nature of the emergency.
Okay.
On Ohio revised code.
But that is Ohio revised code, that's
yes,
not
yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Sorry.
So what are we doing?
I didn't know what this would be.
I will say that if a person attends meetings wants a copy of the packet, then the person that attends the meetings can get the whole ordinance, be able to read it ahead of time also. Because when you come and get the agenda, only the title of the ordinance is on the agenda. And it's also put on the website before the first reading, the entire ordinance. But if you come and pick up an agenda, you're just going to see the heading. Okay, you ready? Okay, the next paragraph is start each emergency resolution. I'm working off my old charter that I marked on, which is different than yours, page-wise. Everybody understand the emergency? It has to have the statement there. And six members have to vote. So it means if there's seven members and two don't show up, they can't get the emergency at that meeting. Okay, no action of council, that paragraph. Separate paragraph. They combine the two. Okay. each resolution and ordinance. Does anybody have any questions about the paragraph? Okay, ready to move on? Next.
I have a question on this next one.
Okay.
Where it says all ordinance, this is Kensburg, where all ordinance and resolutions will be published once in the newspaper of general circulation within the municipality. Do they publish those ordinances or those proposed ordinances or changes on the city's website? Or the general population can review it?
Can I answer that?
Yes.
No, they are put on the website when they were passed. Like if you were to pull up, let's say, ordinance 12-2017, you can go to the city's website, look under ordinances for 2017, pull up that ordinance, and it will tell you when it was passed.
I'm wondering if we need to bring this section into the electronic age, because not many people read newspapers anymore. And that seems to be the only place where you can gain access to this information. I would move that we put some verbiage in here that would indicate that it would also be posted for the public to view on the city's website.
The repository is online, the planning commission right now, the Starbucks and whatnot that's going in. I mean, the repository does put all this online. I don't know if that helps supplement,
but sometimes you can't get access to it unless you.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You only get so many things.
Yeah, it's a big problem.
Yeah, pay for it.
That's another.
Not
that. What?
I'm wondering if it would be more cost effective to place it on the website and maybe post it publicly somewhere within the city hall.
You have to find out if this is
a very nice.
Yeah.
Must publish.
Must publish, but does it say must be published in the newspaper?
Yes. Oh, absolutely. Your local newspaper and it has the readership requirement. It's one of those things that every municipality is required to do that. It certainly helps keep the newspapers.
This was changed. They used to publish the entire ordinance. They changed it to put out they would publish the entire one, the same thing that you see on the agenda.
Again, it may be a moot point. I understand we can't change the statute because of the Ohio Revised Code, but I'm also wondering for greater transparency if we could provide that on the website. That would probably be something.
It actually is. The entire ordinance is posted on the website.
She says after it's passed. I'm talking about
before. That's what this, no, that's what this is, too. No, it's on the agenda, too, before it's passed. Before they have the first reading, mm-hmm. They will put on the website the entire ordinance.
Oh, they do? Okay.
Right. So then once it's passed, then that ordinance is uploaded with the date that it was passed.
Okay. Yes.
Well, no,
it's there in its entirety.
In the words of the late, great Emily Vitello, mm-hmm. Never mind.
That was a good question. Okay, we're ready to start the two actually says Ohio Revised Code. Number four, it says public notice may be given in a manner designated by a majority vote of council. A lot of times, these types of things are put on the water bill so that people know what's happening. For those that get a water bill, some people get what they know, it's electronic. Here, do you have any questions about the whole section 2.05? Are they ready to start with 2.606?
I
the ability of the mandate that the mayor shall appoint the director of administration, which shall be subject to and take effect upon confirmation of by a majority vote of the council. Is that every term? Is, I mean, how does that, okay.
No.
So if council changes and the mayor doesn't change, can somebody explain sort of how that works?
You're on number two, right?
Yeah, I'm on number two, right.
Assuming the director of administration is a position within the city, and once you take that position, you do it once. So it's not something that has to be done on a regular basis every time that the mayor gets.
Okay, so is that a contract position then?
No.
No.
The director of administration is appointed, and then either resigns or is terminated in between. They're there. We'll see, it is last year, there was a lot of discussion in this section if the charter should be changed to a city administrator form of government rather than the mayor council. There were several people came to speak of that, and it was talked about at length, and then it was in the end decided to leave the mayor council.
Because it's, yeah, mayor, administrator, and council.
Right.
It's a term.
Right, yeah. So I don't know if they have anyone that.
Is it working?
Is it that, like Louisville has a city manager?
Is it working is the question. The question we always have to ask ourselves when we look at this stuff.
Right.
Is what we're doing now working?
Right.
If it's broken, we need to fix it, but if it's not.
Okay. I just thought I'd bring it up since.
No, I think that's a good thing to bring up. And it would be nice to hear from people or, opinions of people as to, is it?
It came down, Patrick, to my vote. Put it on the charter and change it to a city administrator.
So how would that change? Would that mean that the city administrator has?
City manager.
The city manager.
And the mayor would be ceremonial.
Right. They would, the city manager would report to the council,
yes.
Not the mayor.
And be in charge of everything. And that would be the person that would be hired on education and qualifications and experience.
Hopefully they hire them now that way too. Is there a fiscal advantage to that? I'm concerned that we're making changes or considering changes just based upon because another local community.
No, it wasn't another local community. I was just making an example.
Yeah.
It was actually brought up,
yeah.
And there were people that came to speak outside of this commission, outside of the commission.
Has anyone brought it up this time?
No.
Okay.
I just thought I'd mention it here.
If there is a fiscal advantage to it that maybe we need to look at.
Right.
But I'm not sure that it wouldn't be just being administrative.
Okay.
Or like the alignment.
Right. Okay, are you ready to go to section 3.02? Second paragraph, the director of administration shall be a resident or shall established resident of the municipality. Ohio Vice Code said that you can't make the director of a city employee live in the city. So this is in, what's in our charter does not go along with Ohio Vice Code.
We should change it.
Maybe delete that word.
I would concur with that. Wasn't that brought up the last time?
It was. I was just going to say.
Yeah, and then the council decided not to do that.
I think that was before there was a determination made by Ohio Vice Code, though that was never changed in the charter. Because we had a director of administration that lived outside the city.
Well, if it's in violation of Ohio Vice Code, then we.
Yeah, we need to take it out.
Yeah.
So everybody agree it should be.
Can we defer to Mr. Fox for confirmation of that?
It actually was on the ballot and the voters not understanding because there's not advertising and so forth for something along those lines, weren't aware that it was contrary to Ohio law and voted in favor of retaining that requirement. And so it has to remain in the charter. And unfortunately, the only way to actually remove it is either by the ballot or if there's a court challenge. And the only way someone's going to be involved in a court challenge is if they are hired and they live outside of the city, then administration may, realizing that it would be unconstitutional to enforce that, it might either be that person or someone else wanting to challenge and say, I live here and that's in our charter, but in all likelihood, that's what would cause it to be removed, to be one of our courts.
We need to ask for a charter.
Yes, ma'am, again, yes, correct.
Okay, any other questions or?
I just have a question on the number of, the last paragraph which says the director of administration may review the budget of the mayor in case of dismissal of the director of administration may request a courtesy hearing for the director of the agency council. It goes on to say decision of the mayor in regard to the removal shall be final. The council has to approve his appointment, his or her appointment, but they don't have to approve his or her termination.
According to her term.
Because he serves at the pleasure of the mayor.
So then my guess is the hearing is solely so that person can get on public record their side. Okay.
Three point oh three. questions or discussion about 3.04? Section 3.04. Any comments or questions about that section? Okay, section 3.05.
Aaron, excuse me just a second. Let's go back to this section, director and law. Just one thing that's always been kind of on my mind in the past is many municipalities have the director of law elected official. Many, rather than an appointment by the council. It seems to work. Just the point of somebody to think about something different. Again, going to you, is the present way working? You'd have to answer that. I'd have to answer that. The city would have to answer that.
The city would have to be sure whether they're voter, they feel they're voter.
Right. So I know other municipalities have it. And so it's, something maybe to think about and go back to it. Like we're going to review certain things later. It's,
be interesting to know how many municipalities elect the director of law rather than have.
Yeah, and what size they are, too. I would imagine a larger municipality would function better.
Right.
I can research that. I'll make some phone calls and see who elects, who appoints, who are in the city. So, okay.
I'm interested in what the advantage would be. I can't think of this off the top of my head.
How many are elected officials?
The difference is if the council has to hire, or the city has to hire, they get to interview. And they get to see a wide spectrum. Whereas if they're elected, and then just who wins the election, and we really don't know what their qualifications are. They are interviewed to see if they work well and mesh well with the community or with the people, the mayor, and the other people at work.
That's true. I agree with that. But at the same time, you don't know what you're getting when you elect a council. The way our present council is, many of them have been appointed by the mayor, and then they ran on their own, and they've been reelected. The problem to that is, if I recall, when that individual, runs on his own, he's the first one up in the box. The incumbent is always hard to beat. They're the first name on the ballot. They're hard to beat. At the same time,
you pretty much said that what I'm hearing your argument is that we need to have the most qualified person. That's not necessarily the incumbent.
That's true.
Okay. So then I think the most qualified person then would be someone who's gone through the process of vetting before hiring.
I'm not sure that.
And then with an elected official, if the person, if there's a problem, the council could remove the law director, but if they're elected, then it would have to be the next election, and they have to be voted out.
And that might not happen with a good campaign machine.
Right. I mean, that's looking at
it. You might not order the law.
look at that. Is it good? I don't know.
That's the purpose of what we're looking at, is to take a look. I believe what is doesn't have to be just because it was. Now, if it's working, then maybe we don't need to change it. But if it's not, then yeah, I agree.
Okay, now we go to 3.05. Tonight I'm watching the time.
I do have a question under number one there. It's the director of finance shall be responsible for collection of all taxes and assessments, et cetera. Now, that has changed now, correct? We didn't read that. Yes. Well, I was introduced to this year. I don't like her. But anyway, so do we need to change the wording of this, or are they still responsible for it? They're just outsourcing.
That's what I'm wondering. If the director of finance made the decision to go with Rita because they're losing the employee.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I don't know.
It still may be under their purview.
Mr. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. The director of finance still maintains responsibility for that. It's simply outsourced for the cost benefit.
Okay.
And it may be temporary if it does improve beneficial to the city. She may then, or the finance director at that point, hire staff to take care of that.
All right. Did that answer the question?
Mary, another question. Did the director of finance actually make the decision to have Rita, or was it the council that made the decision?
I think it was, everybody was involved like a team to see if it was cost effective and more productive, because I understand this Rita has all resources, they're all set up with all their computers. They took her to a higher level. somebody that you report to also?
To the commission, yes.
To the commission. So it says such rules shall be adopted at the sole discretion of the Civil Service Commission. Does that mean the commission has been appointed? Do you not have a resource person though for civil service?
There's three members to the commission.
Okay.
And they're appointed every 6 years. Unless one of them would decide to step down. And then council would appoint the person to fill that position. But they make the decisions, like if there's a promotional exam I have to give, and this is all done by the recommendation of either the police chief going to the director of administration or the fire chief. So I set up, I go to the commission first, let them know what we need in the way of a promotional exam, an entrance exam, or like firefighter EMS or patrolman, then they give the okay to go ahead and schedule the meeting. I do that with an outside company and they administer the exam.
Okay, that's what I was remembering. You have an outside company. Okay, that's
yes.
Where it comes in.
Then once they grade that, once that outside company grades that exam, then we take it back to the commission for them to accept those scores. And they made that decision.
Okay, it also says here, the commission shall prevail over, override, and supersede any and all conflicting or inconsistent general state of Ohio statutes. I thought we had to follow all.
That's a very good question. I was wondering about that.
Yeah.
That was confusing
and we
can't
be
as
in
well.
Conflict. We could be more stringent than the Ohio Revised Code. Follow Ohio Revised Code, can't be in conflict.
Yeah, I read so, that three times
yeah,
and I keep coming up with the same thing, and this commission is more powerful than the Ohio Revised Code.
Right.
And I'm probably reading it wrong.
Actually, this is one of those perfect examples of how home rule authority may conflict head to head with what's provided in the revised code. And our Supreme Court has determined that issues involving civil service rules, that if adopted by a charter, even if they conflict, that our charter will override revised code involving rules for civil service commission.
That's civil service only.
Yes, ma'am. For civil service and there's some other areas, of course, but one of those absolutely is our civil service rules.
Okay. Planning before we go on to Zoning Board of Appeals, it says the Director of Administration and a member of council selected by council shall serve as the voting members of the commission in an advisory capacity and shall attend all meetings. We need to determine if shall is mandatory.
You're doing that last week.
Yeah.
It's my understanding, you know, that the
that's my opinion, I hope you're telling us.
I would concur, and if I may, in having, I also have the responsibility to attend those meetings, but I think perhaps what's most valuable to the planning commission, and perhaps should be in the charter, because every meeting these folks are there, the planning commission relies heavily on the city's engineer and its director of permits. And although I believe they do attend nearly every meeting, having a member of council there, but not those two critical positions, because they're the technical advisors to the planning commission, perhaps may consider the city engineer as well as the director of permits.
Because I attend planning commission meetings, and they're always there, and they are relied very heavily. They bring the plans.
Yes, ma'am.
And explain the plans to the commission. That's good. They're in the same token, and I was to one meeting where the chairman of the planning commission did ask where the council member was, because there was a question that they wanted to ask. I think the reason we have the council person here is as a liaison, and that council person comes back to council, tells them what happened in the planning commission, so there's some continuity. Everybody's on the same page. Okay, so we need to decide if we're going to add engineer, who's the other?
The director of permits.
Director of permits, and then they go anyway, they have a name of the data, so.
My question would those be the only ones, or could we put in a catch-all phrase that says "or others at the discretion of the administrator"?
When you do that, I think they always have the discretion. But if you put certain positions in there, there should be no question that there's a responsibility to be there. There's always the availability for the director administration to say, or others to attend, and of course I think that they would.
So does everybody concur that we should do the charter change to add to this section?
So you're saying you create a director of administration and a member of council select
the director of planning. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, yeah, I'm sorry. Just to make sure.
Go ahead and read it.
The director of administration and member of council selected by council, and city engineer and director of permits would they still serve as non-voting members?
Yeah.
Correct.
So all four individuals would just be
engineer and the director.
Yeah.
Okay, so what you're saying now is they must be there.
Shall.
Right. And perhaps worded in kind of hierarchy of their status, the director of administration, city engineer, the director of permits, as well, and then as separate, and a member of council selected by council.
Okay, but you would take care of that in writing up?
Yes, ma'am.
So we have the same at the bottom of the paragraph, director of administration.
should be inserted that the zoning board of appeals shall hear appeals? Or is that more for the ordinance? You know what I'm talking about?
Well, referring to the last paragraph there. In, as it's stated, that board hears appeals for exceptions and it actually hears appeals for decisions of, normally it's in the planning and zoning areas for those.
To me, it's a person who comes and asks for a variance, which is an appeal, and they decide that appeal. I'm talking about appeals.
Also, in other words, if the zoning board of appeals declines the person's appeal, you're saying about the person being able to appeal.
But there was a situation in the city where it was clarified that the zoning board of appeals should hear the appeals.
Correct.
Should that be spelled out here very explicitly?
Well, it says it's the duty of the Zoning and Building Standard Board of Appeals to hear and decide appeals or exceptions to and variations in the applications of ordinance or regulations of administrative officials or agencies governing buildings in and controlling. So I believe that definitely covers the appeals, but looking at that six, one of the absolute things that they do is hearing the variances. So perhaps spell it out a little clearer for a variance as an exception to our rules, as well as hearing appeals for exceptions. I think perhaps it could be worded a little more clearly.
Is the board hearing both the variance and then the appeal of that?
No, it would actually hear a variance that was appealed would go to the Common Pleas Court.
Right.
But if there was something that wasn't necessarily a variance, but say a disagreement, whether or not, and sometimes we might see that with a housing issue, where someone received a housing violation and they wish to appeal that, we provide them a notice of appeal that they may take that to this board to have that dispute heard. If that then is appealed, it would go to our Common Pleas Court. I'll take a crack at rewording.
I was going to say, and I do the same thing to myself, you know, just sort of look at it, but I think that maybe this is a paragraph that we should revisit once, you know, we've had some time to, because I do think it's confusing, and I do think that there have been
issues. It's two different things they're doing, but it's all in one paragraph.
That's correct.
It is above.
I agree.
It's above.
We'll clear it up.
But then, if we have to go to the voters, would that be a change or just clearing? Does this have to be voted on or just reworded?
Let me look at that too.
Okay.
Just be
clear. I'll just put a big question mark. Okay, it's 8:25, and our time to adjourn is 8:30, so is this a good time to stop? Are you going to keep going and going? You look on the news.
It's not to me, it's not like, but everybody else, if you've got 5 minutes left, I'm going to work on 5 minutes,
I think to keep our minds from going spinning.
You start another article.
Yeah.
For taxation.
Clear it right now.
Yeah. So that would clear your mind. Okay, so then, what I wanted to talk about next meeting is that we really fixed the and then I had an email, I'm sure everybody else got it, that our one member has lying for meetings for 2 minutes. But he wasn't here to defend himself, I was going to say is, since there's really only one home track meet on Tuesday night, to make the time for 7, because the other ones on Tuesday are away meets, and the person who said she could be here by 7, no way could be here by 7 with an away meet. Because there's travel time, you know, so that they would be here. So we could keep it Tuesday, but change the time to earlier.
Tuesdays really don't work for me moving forward, so I'll just throw another wrench in the way. Sorry. It's okay, it's hard to get everybody together. What did you talk about with Wednesdays? Wednesdays, they have zoning board, appeal, and planning commission. That's 2 Wednesdays, but sometimes they don't have agendas and they cancel their meetings. Can't do Mondays. Nobody wants to do Friday, Saturday or Sunday. Say something. Can you not attend any Tuesdays?
No, I just, there's, it would just be interns.
I think that's how it is with everybody though.
I'm sorry, I just thought we'd be getting you to stand by Thursday.
But there are any big discussions that I have. For a fluid issue. Still have a.
I'm comfortable with either or, if I can admit my schedule. It's just one way if you lose a person, if you miss it, it's uncomfortable for them. The other way if you lose a person, it's good.
I thought that she had arranged with your school.
No, just for the swearing in. But again, I'm 1 of 15, I do not schedule it with this. The goal is a charter. Please don't make my schedule affect anyone else's. The goal is the charter, so if Thursday is the best for you, that's the goal.
I guess the question is, if we lose her because she can't miss any more school, do we have to replace her in order to maintain the 15 person?
We don't have to replace her.
If someone would resign, I believe they should be replaced, but there is no minimum number of convenience. I think it's really set by yourselves.
When is your school over?
I graduate May 7th. And we have to have this proposed by April, so I mean it would be for the coming third. I have class every Thursday, 6:15, so. But again, the goal is the charter. Please don't let my school get in that way.
The reason that I don't set how many people like to think about. And then if you maybe get on the computer, do some research, find out other things. Okay. Motion to adjourn.
Oh, you're right. Second.